Hi, welcome back. Welcome to Insect Systematics lecture series. So we were discussing the general characters of orders and economically important families. In the previous class of lecture 13, we started discussion on the order Coleoptera. In this lecture, as lecture 13b, I'll be talking about suborder Polyphaga. So in under 13a, we completed the discussion on the suborder Ardiphaga. Okay, so this is where we are. Under the division Neoptera, there are three subdivisions: Polyneoptera. Polyneopterans are exoterygotan insects with biting and chewing type of mouthparts. Whereas subdivision Paraneoptera, these are also exoterygotan insects, but they have got piercing and sucking type of mouthparts. Whereas subdivision Oligoneoptera are endoterygotan insects, insects with complete metamorphosis, or insects with four stages. Okay, so since previous class, we were discussing on the order Coleoptera. Okay, so in fact, there are four suborders under Coleoptera: Ardiphaga, Polyphaga, Archostomata, and Mixophaga. So in the previous class itself, I said only Ardiphaga and Polyphaga will be discussed, as they are major suborders. Archostomata and Mixophaga are minor suborders. Okay, so important, representatives of Ardiphaga are ground beetles, tiger beetles, predatory diving beetles. Whereas the Polyphagan representatives are scarabid beetles, ladybird beetles, kick beetles, etc. In fact, Polyphaga is highly diversified. So what are the difference between Ardiphaga and Polyphaga? So wing venation usually with an oblongum. There is a cell-like structure in the hind wing. Okay, whereas no cell is formed in case of hind wing in Polyphagan insects. Other distinguishing characters includes notopleural suture, visible on dietroventral side. Okay, if you turn the insect and see, you'll find a line. Okay, you can see this line. This is the notopleural suture, which is present only in Ardiphagan families. Whereas in case of Polyphagan families, we will not find any such line. Okay, so that is another difference. Another important difference is that hind coccyx is firmly fixed to the first abdominal segment. As a result, first abdominal segment actually divided. You can see here. So it extends like this. So, but it is divided. Okay, if you see this number, you can see it is divided because of the coxa 3, hind coxa. Okay, whereas in case of Polyphaga, so hind coxa is not firmly fixed to first abdominal segment, but you can see here, as a result of that, so the first visible abdominal sternite in fact is not separated. Okay, it is continuous, in fact, you can see here. Okay, so that's how you can distinguish Ardiphaga and Polyphaga. So coming to important families of Polyphaga. Okay, so in case of Ardiphaga, we discussed three families, but Polyphaga is highly diversified. That's why now we'll be studying more number of families. Okay, in fact, again, I reiterate, so only we are studying the tip of the iceberg. In fact, now hundreds of families have been identified even in Polyphaga. So we'll be taking only the economically important families. So now try to follow my pronunciation. Hydrophilidae, they are called water scavenger beetles. Staphylinidae, row beetles. Scarabidae, Mayjune beetles, dung rollers, lamellicorn beetles. Buprestidae, metallic wood borers. Lampyridae, fireflies. Elatridae, click beetles. Dermestidae, skin beetles. Coccinellidae, ladybird beetles. Tenebriumidae, darkling beetles. Meloidae, blister beetles. Cerambycidae, longicorn beetles. Chrysomelidae, leaf beetles. Curculionidae, weevils. Okay. So probably you may feel that it is now tough to remember, but now many of these insects you are actually have seen during your day-to-day activities. So once you see those specimens, you will definitely say that yes, you have seen this insect, and you will start recognizing with a specific character. So that's why I know you need not to fear to remember these many number of families. So it will become common sense once you start seeing those insects, or as you have seen these insects already, it becomes very easy to remember. So we'll start one by one. Hydrophilidae, they are called water scavenger beetles. So if you see these specimens, you may feel that we have seen these insects already. We have seen this type of specimen and also family already. Okay, so it looks like Dieticidae. So in the previous class, I was telling about predatory diving beetle. Okay, so there, in fact, it is actually that Dieticidae belongs to suborder Ardiphaga, whereas Hydrophilidae belongs to Polyphaga. Okay, so then which is that distinguishing character? How do you distinguish these two families? This is where you need to concentrate. So these are also convex beetles. That's why actually it confuses. Otherwise, the distinguishing characters includes antennae short. Okay, antennae, you can see here, it's short, but maxillary palpi is longer than the antennae. Okay, but if you see the Dytiscidae, it is in fact reverse. So that's how you can now start recognizing these insects. So there is a metasternal spine, which is present, often prolonged posteriorly into a long spine. If you turn the insect, okay, in the ventral side, you'll find a spine. Okay, this metasternal spine is actually long, which actually fits into a groove found in the metasternum region. Okay, prosternum, mesosternum, metasternum. This is where I am talking about. Okay, so that means metasternal spine present, which is often prolonged posteriorly into a long spine, and there will be a groove, metasternum with a transverse groove. Okay, if you remember this, now metasternal spine, you can easily distinguish now Dytiscidae from Hydrophilidae. That means Dytiscidae will not have such spine. So these hydrophilids are aquatic and are principally scavengers. Okay, whereas the Dytiscids are predaceous. Okay, common species includes Hydrophilus carabidus, Hydrophilus kashmiriensis. Okay, you can remember, I think. So what is the difference between Dytiscidae and Hydrophilidae? Antennae long, longer than the maxillary palpi. Whereas in case of Hydrophilidae, antennae short. Maxillary palpi longer than the antennae. Okay, you can see this antennae, which is maxillary palpi, is longer. Whereas you can see here, this antennae is longer than the maxillary palpi. Okay. Therefore, you can distinguish these two families. So metasternal spine is absent. Metasternal spine is present, which fits into a groove. Okay, here. So no spine, no such groove in case of Dytiscidae. Very easy, right? Yeah. So next family, Staphylinidae. They are called row beetles. Okay, slender, elongate, 1 to 25 mm. So that means there are different species. Some measuring very small, some are long. Recognized by short elytra. Very important feature of these beetles, Staphylinids, are short elytra. You can see here. So usually in case of beetles, almost this elytra completely covers the abdomen. Okay, but in few cases, so abdominal segments are exposed like this. Okay, so which covers, you know, very few abdominal segments. As a result of that, 3 to 6 abdominal segments are exposed. So very characteristic feature, in fact. So antennae, whereas it is long, it may be filiform or clubbed. Okay. So abdomen is flexible. Okay. This part is flexible. And if you put now sarsi for this diagram, this photo, it looks like earwig. Okay. So it looks like Dermoptera earwigs, but these row beetles lack sarsi. Okay. In case of earwigs, so hard sclerotized sarsi will be present. Okay, so that's how we can distinguish these two. Majority are predaceous, some are saprophytic, and few are found in termite area, as in quillins. So they live inside the mound of termites. Some examples includes Paedirus fusipus. They are brightly colored and secretion is in fact allergic. Oligota voviformis, it is a predaceous on mites, thereby it is beneficial. Staphylinus caesareus, which attacks and feeds on the fly larvae and dipteran larvae. Okay. Next family, Scarabidae. They are called May June beetles, Lamellicorn beetles, chaffers, dung rollers, white grubs. Okay, you have seen this type of insects. Okay, now if you see this dung roller, you can easily say they are scarabids. You have seen this type of rhinoceros beetles. Okay, you have seen this type of grubs. So they all belongs to family Scarabidae. So they vary greatly in size, color, and habits. Okay, you can see here itself, there are different colored insects. Okay, their habitat also changes. They are heavy bodied, in fact. So most of them you can see are heavy bodied, oval beetles usually, and their PGDM is exposed. What is this PGDM? So I was telling that in case of previous, you know, Staphylinidae, subdominal segments exposed. So here in this case also, elytra in fact do not entirely covers the abdomen like this. So even partly, the subdominal part is exposed. The last abdominal segment may be exposed, which is called PGDM. Okay, so which is common feature of most of these carabids. Okay, antennae lamellate. We have studied the types of antennae. You can see here, the last three antennal segments are actually expanded into plate-like, which is called lamellate type of antenna. And these carabids possess this type of now lamellate antenna, hence they are also called, scarabid beetles are also called lamellicorn beetles. So that's the now nomenclature. So many are dung feeders, some nests in ants and termites. Many of them are phytophagous. Some of them are very serious pests by feeding on the roots. Okay, like white grubs. Okay, flowers, foliage, even they attack. Okay, so they have got no highly diversified feeding habit. Larvae of these scarabids are C-shaped, you can see here. Okay, hence they are called scarabiform. Okay, so especially you might have find in case of FYM pit, okay, farmyard manure pit. So they are, okay, scarabiform larvae. Example includes Rhinoceros beetle, Oryctes rhinoceros, this is the insect. Okay, Araconid white grub, Leucopolis leptopora, one of the serious pests of Araconid. Okay, like that there are no serious pests, whereas some of them are beneficial, like this dung roller. Okay. So in fact, this family, Scarabidae, is actually one of the biggest family. Okay, so hence, number of subfamilies have been recognized. So if I say subfamily, I think you can easily say it is subfamily if the name ends with I-N-A-E, Ine. Okay, Cetonine, they are commonly called flower choppers. Dynastine, they are called Rhinoceros beetles. Melonthine, they are called white grubs. Rutiline, they are called leaf choppers. Scarabinae, they are called dung beetles. Okay, so there are a number of subfamilies. So don't worry about the identification feature of these subfamilies. We'll be talking about only the identification characters of families. Next family, Buprestidae. Probably now you are feeling, oh, because this is the insect which might have you played during your children days, right? Okay, so you used to put a thread to the neck of these type of insects, jewel beetles, and used to play with that. Okay, so in fact, larvae of these insects acts as wood borers. Okay, because of its coloration, they are called jewel beetles. Adults typically, they are metallic or bronze colored with bullet-shaped body, very hard body in fact. Head is sunken into prothorax. You can see here, it is not visible from the above. This is the head part. Okay, almost it is found below the prothorax, which is actually comparatively prolonged. Head is sunken into prothorax. This is the reason. Okay, antennae is serrate. You can see here. Okay, serrate type of antennae. So there will be 5 visible abdominal sterna. So I'm talking of sterna, not tergum. Tergum is upper part, sternum is the ventral part. So 5 abdominal sterna are visible. So larvae are wood borers. So sometimes they act as very serious pests of forest trees, in fact. So, but some of the crops are also attacked, like Stenoptera gossypi on cotton, Spenoptera perotetti on groundnut, like that. So these are the few very important beetles, okay, Sternocera species, in fact. Found in forest habitats and very colorful beetles, in fact. So more jewel beetles again here. So they are highly diversified, highly colorful. In fact, if you see the world diversity, you'll find a lot of very differently colored jewel beetles. Next family, Lampyridae. They are called fireflies. Probably you might have seen during your night hours that fireflies flying out about in the evening. So they are actually flying fireflies, which have got a bioluminescent character. They have the ability to produce the light. So they are also called glowworms, lightning bugs. Okay. Both adults and larvae produce the light. This is the larvae you can see here, grubs in fact. In special organs in their abdomen, in a process called bioluminescence. They are elongate, 5 to 20 mm, soft-bodied, yet concealed by pronotum, you can see. Okay, like in the previous Buprestidae I was talking about. So luminescent organ, light producing organs, okay, present on 5th and 6th segment in case of males, 7th in case of females. Okay, even grubs can produce the light. They fly about in the evening and conspicuous by their blinking yellow lights. Okay, so that has got a very important ecological importance in fact. Okay, so especially they are produce light in order to attract the opposite sex. Larvae are predaceous on snails and slugs, you can see here. So insects feeding on snails and slugs. Lamproporos tardus, Lamproporos tenebronus on Acatina fulica. Acatina fulica is a snail, in fact, a very serious pest of our crops. That will be attacked by this glowworm larvae. Okay, so that's how it is beneficial. Elatridae, they are called click beetles. Okay, so you might have seen this type of insects. Characteristic shape, body elongate, parallel sided, okay, rounded at both the ends. Yeah. Posterior corners of the pronotum prolonged into a sharp points, you can see here. Okay, it is extended into sharp points. Very clear here, you can see. So there is a prosternal spine. This is the prosternal spine. Okay, sterna, talking about prosternal spine, which fits into a mesosternal depression. There will be a groove there. So as a result of that, usually this insect that spine actually pushes back and which fits into a mesosternal spine and it jump. Okay, so that modification is actually helpful in jumping by making clicking noise. So that's why they are called click beetles. So elotrids are called click beetles. Okay, I repeat, prosternal spine fits into a mesosternal depression. This helpful in jumping with a clicking noise. Okay, larvae are slender, shiny, and are called wireworms. Why they are called wireworms? They are very hard, in fact. So thereby, in fact, they live in soil. They are destructive. Feed on seeds, roots, some on rotting wood, but few of them are predaceous. Okay, so pyrophorus species in South India, which produces the light, in fact. Okay, so not just Lampyridae, fireflies, produce light, but elotrids do produce the sound. Cardioporus notatus, Cardioporus quadrimaculatus, few examples. Click beetles. Next family, Dermestidae. They are called skin beetles. Why they are called skin beetles is that they are skin colored and there will be a lot of hairs on its body. That's why they are called skin beetles. Okay, small, oval, convex with short clubbed antenna. Okay, you can see here. Head often with a median ocellus. So you will find only one ocellus. Remember this character. This is a family character of Dermestidae. Elytra and body covered with scales. So a lot of hairs on its body. So usually scavengers, but also feeds on feather, leather, fur, silk, skin, museum specimens, stored food. Like Trogoderma granarium, Atogenous faecius, Dermestes maculatus. Some of them are actually feeds on stored food and acts as pests. Next family, Coccinellidae, ladybird beetles. Who has not seen this type of insects? Very familiar with this. Small, 0.8 to 10 mm. Oval, hemispherical bodied. Convex, often brightly colored. So they are recognized by bright coloration, in fact. Head partly concealed, often above by the pronotum. So very small head, in fact, covered by the pronotum. So very important character. So this can be easily identified with this character, but we have to really look under microscope. Which is that character? Tarsi appearing 3-3-3. I think there is no confusion if I say tarsal formula 3-3-3. That means 4 tarsi, mid tarsi, hind tarsi. But they have got 4-4-4 tarsomeres. That means it appears like 3, but it is not 3. It's actually 4-4-4. So, for example, if you see from this ventral side, you can see here. This is the tibia, in fact, tarsi 1, 2, 3, 4. You can see. But if you see from the ventral side, what happens? So this segment is actually, the third segment is actually concealed because of the long second tarsomere. And as a result, you may count it as 1, 2, 3. So but actually it will have 4, 4, 4. So that's why it's called a pseudo-trimerous condition. Pseudo-trimerous. It is not actually 3, but it's actually 4, 4, 4. So larvae are campodiform. So prognathous type of mouth parts with well-developed mandibles in order to capture and prey. So both the grubs and adults, in fact, acts as predator on many other groups of insects like scales, mealybugs, aphids. You can see it's feeding on mealybugs and aphids. Thereby they are beneficial insects, in fact. Mainly predators, both in grubs and adult stage. Few of them are phytophagous. Very few species under this Coccinellidae are phytophagous like this one. So few examples includes Coccinella septum punctata. You can easily remember, right? Septum punctata, Cryptolemus montrosieri. There is another species which acts as pest, especially on Solanaceous vegetables, is Inosepilatna vigintio octopunctata. Long scientific name. Try to remember this. So let's discuss about the life cycle of ladybird beetles being very beneficial insects. So these beetles usually lays this elongated, oval, shiny, yellowish eggs, in fact, usually most of them, which hatches into a grubs. Grubs are also predatory on various insects like aphids. Here they are feeding. And pupa. Pupa will usually have spines on the posterior part of the body. And it's adult, hemispherical bodied, very colorful. Next family, Tenebrionidae. So they are called darkling beetles, mealworms. So they are called darkling beetles because they are active at night. So, but they are again large and varied group. So here the tarsal formula is 5-5-4. Why it is important? So few of them look like ground beetles. Ground beetles, Adipega. Adipega will have tarsomeres tarsal formula 555, whereas the polyphaga will have the tarsal formula varied. Okay, so they look like ground beetles. If you look for this tarsal character, if it is not 555, you can easily say that it is polyphaga and it may be Tenebrionidae. Right. Okay, so another very important character is eye snatched or emarginated. What is this? So because of the antennal insertion in the head region, okay, so part of this, okay, the compound eye is actually notched. You can see here, it runs like this. Yes. Okay, it is actually notched or emarginated, you can say. Okay, so compound eyes are emarginated. Antennae 11 segmented, filiform or muriliform, arise beneath the frontal ridge. So below the frons in this region, and as a result of that, compound eyes actually looks notched. So found on ground beneath the stones, under bark, in nests of birds, ants, termites, and some of them are actually acts as pests installed, produce as well. So like gonocephalum species, ragi, in case of ragi, it acts as pest by feeding on roots. Tribolium castaneum is called red floor beetle. This is the one very common, I think all of you have seen found feeding on cereals. Tenebrio molitor, which is called mealworm. So in fact, it is now used as food in Western countries, especially in the larval stage, mealworm. Okay. Next family, Meloidae, they are called blister beetles. Very common, you have seen this type of eye-class species. Okay, so blister beetles. Head strongly deplexed, look like bent. Elytra is soft. Okay, very rarely in few families we will find the soft elytra. Okay, whereas most of the beetles will have very hard elytra. So they are also brightly colored. Pronotum is narrower than head as well as elytra. You can see here, this is the pronotum, which is narrower than the head, pronotum, and abdomen. Okay, is narrower. So larvae undergo hypermetamorphosis. You recall the meaning of hypermetamorphosis, wherein each instar, the grub or the larval stage, will have different forms. Okay, so like first instar is called triangulin or panidium, second instar is caraboid, third and fourth instar is caraboid, fifth is non-functional mouth part, that does not feed, and sixth is actually squalatoid type, which has got functional mouth part. So there is a lot of variation within the different instars. Okay, this is called hypermetamorphosis. So these blister beetles, usually when they are handled, in fact they release a chemical substance called cantharidin through the leg joints, which actually irritates our skin, which causes blisters on the skin. So that's why they are called blister beetles, but it has got medicinal properties. Example includes Lytta vesicatoria, Epicata tenucalis, like this. Okay, very common. In fact, this eye-class species is very common. Next family, Ceramicidae. I think all of you have seen this type of beetles with long antenna. That's why they're called long-armed beetles or longicorn beetles. So they are elongate, cylindrical with long antenna. Okay, long antenna. So sometimes this antenna extend to 2/3 the length of the body, or half as long as the body, or sometimes it is longer than the body. Okay, eyes are strongly emarginated. I was telling in case of Tenebrionidae, remember. Okay, so here also it is notched. You can see here. So because of the antennal insertion, this compound eyes looks emarginated. Sometimes, so this antennal insertion is so characteristic is that compound eyes looks divided. Okay, so compound eye looks like 4, in fact. So tarsi apparently 4-4-4, but actually 5-5-5. Remember, so same type of things which we were discussing in case of Coccinellidae, where I said pseudo trimerous condition, whereas I am telling now we are as pseudo tetramerous condition. Pseudo tetra, it is not 4-4-4, but 5-5-5. So here you can see, if you see from one side, it looks like 1-2-3-4. Okay, so the fourth one actually is a problematic here. You can see here, this is tibia, but you can start counting tarsi. 1, 2, 3, and fourth one you can see here. So there is a segment here, 4 and 5. Okay, you have to really look under microscope for this character so that you can recognize that pseudo tetramerous condition. So, but actually 5, 5, 5. So most larvae are wood boring, thereby it acts as a serious pest of woody plants. Example, mango stem borer, Batocera rufomaculata, this specimen in fact. So, and this specimen is actually very serious pest of coffee, which is called coffee white stem borer. So in the larval stage, that says very serious pest. Okay, Xylotrechus quadripus, this is the one. Next family, Chrysomelidae. They are called leaf beetles, flea beetles, tortoise beetles. Okay. Closely related to Ceramicidae, but they have short antenna. You can see here. Okay, it is not like, you know, half the length of the body or longer than the body. Okay. So small in size, oval bodied, hind femur sometimes swollen, like this you can see here. So as a result of that, they are able to jump, hence they are also called flea beetles. Okay, so because of the swollen hind femur. So they are also called tortoise beetles, you can see here. Look like tortoise. Okay. So eyes here, it is not emarginated. I said they are closely related to Ceramicidae. In case of Ceramicidae, you'll find that no emarginated eyes, but here eyes are not emarginated. Okay. Tarsi again, it's pseudo tetramerous like the previous Ceramicids. So they are metallic, brightly colored phytophagous insects. Larvae especially feeds on roots, leaves, seeds, and also acts as stem borers. You might have seen this type of specimens. Okay. So Alacophora fovicalis, which is called pumpkin beetles, very common in cucurbits. Okay. Zygogramma bicolorata, which is called Parthenium weed killer. So definitely you'll find in Parthenium where it will be feeding on Parthenium, thereby helpful in a reduction in the weeds of this very important weed, Parthenium. Okay, thereby it acts as weed killer, Zygogramma bicolorata. Okay. So there is another insect which is very serious in stored pulses, which is called Calosobrucus chinensis. Okay, it's called Brookid, in fact. So earlier it was actually placed under the family called Brookidae. Now it is downgraded as Brookinae under the family Chrysomelidae. That's why just I'm mentioning this subfamily name called Brookinae. They are called pulse beetles or seed beetles. Okay, so you might have seen if you have stored pulses in your home for long duration, definitely. So these beetles will attack. Next family, Curculionidae, they are called weevils. All of you have seen this type of weevils, beetles. The large family in animal kingdom. In fact, number of species have been described under this family. Head produced into a rostrum. You can see here, and mouth parts are found at the tip. Okay, here there is no labrum, in fact. Antennae is geniculate. Okay, you can see here. Okay, like in case of honeybees, ants, these two weevils also have got geniculate type of antenna. Third and fourth segment is, in fact, last three or four segments are actually compact and they are clubbed. Abdomen with five visible sterna, as you see from the ventral side, wherein first and second abdomen segments are fused. Okay, so weevils vary in the habits. They may act as defoliators, root feeders, stem borers, leaf miners, flower feeders, etc. Very diversified. So there is a very serious pest on palms like coconut, arecanut, red palm weevil, Rhynchophorus ferruginous. Millocera species like this, ash weevils. Rice weevil like this in Cytophilus, it's called Cytophilus varese, very common in rice. So as I was mentioning, in case of Scarabidae, that is also biggest family, in fact. Curculionidae also has some number of subfamilies. Just I will pronounce, try to remember these, because in the future courses, you may come across with these type of names. Dryopterinae, they're called true weevils. Curculionidae, they're called flower weevils or acorn or nut weevils. Very long snout, you can see, very characteristic. Short-nosed weevils, Entimina. Platypodinae, they're called ambrosia beetles. Ambrosia is a fungus. They cultivate this fungus, in fact, for survival. Squalitinae, they're called bark beetles. Especially, you might have seen windows or many other, woody plants, you may find very small holes. Okay, and if you keep your ear nearby, small noise will be coming out. So they're called bark beetles, very small, minute beetles, in fact. So how do you collect and preserve the Coleoptera? So collection, again, depending on the insects which you are targeting, different families which you are targeting. So good flying insects can be collected using insect net. On vegetation, you can easily target, use sweep net. So ant collection, you can directly collect on flowers, some of the sedentary beetles. But many of the carrion beetles can be collected using baited traps. Many species are attracted to light traps, of course. Okay, so many beetles. Crawling beetles can be collected using pitfall trap. Okay, aquatic beetles, you can use the aquatic net or dip net. But again, many of these hydrophilids and dieticids are attracted to light as well. Okay, so where do you pin the specimen? So on the right of the midline, on the base of the elytra, okay, you need to insert the entomological pins. Okay, depending on the size of the beetles. Many of them are small beetles, but many of them are big beetles. So under that condition, depending on the type of the beetle, we have to use the entomological pins of different numbered. It may be, if it is a small beetle, you can go for 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, depending on the size of the beetle. Okay, or you can use the paper point as well for small beetles especially. Okay, you can glue it on the paper points. Paper points can be prepared with the help of this type of punching machine, and which actually gives the triangular paper points, and that paper point has to be bent little with the help of forceps, and specimen has to be glued on the thoracic region. Okay, so that the entire other part is visible for microscopic examination. So the pinned specimen or labeled specimen, okay, labeling is very much important, which consists of a locality label and identification label. Then it has to be preserved in cabinet boxes after drying. Okay. So before ending, I'm showing some of the visuals, but there are questions in this. Okay. So in which family you'll find this metasternal spine, which actually fits into a groove? Okay. Aquatic beetle, remember. So then there is a prosternal spine, which fits into a mesosternal groove. It makes the noise. I'm giving a clue. Where do you find this pseudo trimerous condition? 1, 2, 3, 4. Pseudo trimerous condition, but 4, 4, 4 tarsal segment. So tortoise beetles belongs to family. Ladybird beetle belongs to family. Glowworms or fireflies belongs to which family? So try to answer this. Okay. You may feel tough, but repeatedly if you discuss or go through the slides, lectures, it becomes very easy. Okay. So in fact, it's a Coleoptera is actually the number one order, largest order, with 389,487 species described worldwide. And in India, 17,455 species have been described so far. Okay. So that means 35 to 38% of insect species described so far are beetles alone. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, you can post below or you can email me as well. Thank you. Thank you very much.